Greetings, I'm Mr. Spiffy, and welcome to a new segment that I will be doing over the next, well, 27 weeks or so, called Surviving Survivor Series, where I'm going to go down the line looking at the classic that is Survivor Series, the second oldest WWE pay-per-view that there is. And I figure, being that it's a classic, I'm going to wear a shirt for New School Classic. A independent wrestling tag team here in California called the Classic Connection. If you haven't seen them, they're probably one of the best running tag teams, in my opinion, right now in California. And certainly, they are definitely a throwback to the classic Midnight Express. Definitely worth checking out if you have time on YouTube. So, for the next, like, 27 weeks or so, I'm going to be counting down all of the Survivor Series events, and giving you my thoughts and opinions on this event overall. As I'm calling it Surviving Survivor Series, ironically, I named this far before I started watching these matches again and reviewing it, but I've noticed that slogging through some of the earlier ones, it really is kind of surviving. So let's get right down to 1987. This was the WWE's first time of stepping away from the concept of just WrestleMania and expanding on it and having a new pay-per-view concept, Survivor Series. 5-on-5 elimination matches where, and then of course some massive tag team matches. The tag teams that we're used to where it can come down to literally just one man surviving. And it was a very unique and interesting concept. I think that one of the main tripping points, it was both an appeal and a tripping point for this particular event, was that every match was exactly the same type. And so after a while, it did get a little stale. But we'll see how it goes. Let's start back to Thanksgiving, 1987, with the very first Survivor Series. The very first Survivor Series match featured the team of the Honky Tonk Man, King Harley Race, Outlaw Ron Bass, Hercules, and Devious Danny Davis, the evil referee, versus the team of the Macho Man Randy Savage, Jake the Snake Roberts, Brutus the Barber Beefcake, Hacksaw Jim Duggan, and Ricky the Dragon Steamboat. Each one of these men had some sort of beef with the other on the other side, and it made for a very interesting matchup. And I think the main draw away from this matchup, despite the fact that they actually had really good stories, was, of course, Honky Tonk Man doing what Honky Tonk Man always does, which is running away. Which is literally how he survived as being the longest reigning Intercontinental Champion of all time, was constantly taking that powder at the end of a matchup. Let's see here. So stories, at least for one guy on each side had a beef with the other, as I mentioned. The ref kept getting squished in the corner. And it wasn't due to the wrestlers trying to give him a ref bump. The ref just seemed lost in that matchup, and he kept going into different corners, and it was just a situation where he really did not seem to know where the hell he was going. And it was just really bad ring positioning on that ref's part. In the end, Jake the Snake Roberts, Macho Man Randy Savage, and Ricky the Dragon Steamboat were the survivors for that matchup when Honky Tonk Man took off at the end of it. I gave the match a B-. Definitely a good one. We had an interview backstage with Andre the Giant and his team, and Andre went and used one of his lines from The Princess Bride. I am here for you, soul. A little bit of the geek in me just was like, ee! It was just like, yeah. We went to the very first of the women's matches for the Survivor Series. The Glamour Girls teamed with Dawn Marie, not the one who was in the lesbian scene with Tori Wilson. This was another Dawn Marie years earlier. Donna Cittarinello. There's a mouthful if I've ever heard one. And Sensational Sherry. Versus Velvet McIntyre, Rockin' Robin, the Jumping Bomb Angels, and the Fabulous Moolah. Ending with the Bomb Angels surviving. Comments I made during this matchup, just because I take notes as I go, is Rockin' Robin definitely looked lost out there. Like, I don't know if she was green, but, like, something about how she was doing it, like, she did not seem to know where she was going. I don't know if she got concussed early on in the matchup. I don't know what happened, but whatever it was, she was just, like, all over the place and did not seem to know what she was doing, and especially in comparison to the other women. At one point, she was hitting the ropes really badly. She was stutter-stepping, which is like taking way too many steps going across the ring. Like, she just looked like she had no concept of what her foot positioning and her ring positioning was supposed to be. And I did this write out while I was still at PCW and I was watching and listening. So I've watched people who stutter-step in the ring, and that was just kind of awful. You had the Bomb Angels, who were just an amazing Japanese duo, and they really made me sad that the women's wrestling died out in the WWF just a few months after that. Both of those women were solid talents. Of course, they were the last reigning WWF women's tag team champions, and honestly, you know, they went out in a blaze of glory on that one. They definitely put on a better matchup overall, and this is one of the very few matches you actually see Sensational Sherry wrestle, because Sherry, throughout most of the career that we see her, we're used to seeing her as a manager, so it's a very unique situation, especially because Sherry was the women's champion, and she was eliminated about midway through the matchup. It wasn't like she was the last woman surviving. She was the women's champion, and she was beat at some point. But overall, decent match. I gave it a C+. Now we get into what I refer to as one of the two biggest clusterfucks in the history of professional wrestling. And that is the 10 tag team matchup. This is an ill-conceived concept, because it's like having a lumberjack match with all the lumberjacks on the freaking apron. There's barely any room to run the ropes. There's obviously, you know, they weren't going to go, they didn't do any of the reach tags, they didn't do any of that kind of stuff back then. It was obvious, you know, that, you know, there should be no reason that any man should ever be eliminated or isolated during that kind of matchup, because literally all of his partners are at any time within arm's reach, practically. It was just, it's a ridiculous concept. They did it 2, maybe 3 times, and it just doesn't work. This one featured the Bolsheviks, the Heart Foundation, Demolition, the Islanders, and the Dream Team versus Strike Force, the Fabulous Rougeau Brothers, the Killer Bees, the British Bulldogs, and the Young Stallions. One of the things that ended this matchup was the Killer Bees at the end put on their masks halfway through, towards the end of the matchup, so you couldn't tell who was who, and picked up the win. This is a very heel tactic, but the Killer Bees were, throughout their entire WWF run, to the best of my knowledge, babyfaces. They used a consistent heel tactic of basically swapping positions. And while the Bella Twins did that at some points during their face run and it worked, it's a traditionally very heel tactic, and I didn't understand it. It was very against the norm for that time frame. It's both a good thing and a bad thing. All in all, despite the clusterfuckiness of the matchup, the in-ring action that we did get was pretty decent. I gave it a C, but it's just because stuff kept changing, and it wasn't anything that, you know, you could really follow or give anything, you know, more investment to than just being, wow, there's a lot of fucking tag teams out here. We then had a very, very, very long Million Dollar Man Ted DiBiase promo vignette, where he was talking about how he spends his Thanksgiving, and, you know, he was trying to establish how he was going to buy the WWF Championship. They spent a lot of time with Ted DiBiase and what he was doing and how money brings him everything. And that's great for the gimmick, but when you've got a 2.5-hour pay-per-view, spending 20 minutes on a vignette is not a solid way to handle it. One of the things I noted is that Gorilla Monsoon kept using the term a happening far too much. She's like, this is a happening, this is a happening, this whole thing's a happening. Not Gorilla's best time on the microphone. I've heard him do better. And actually the following year, he also refers to it as a happening, but at least he only does that maybe once. Honky Tonk Man gets interviewed backstage. My note is nothing special. It's literally just, I'm the Intercontinental Champion and I made the decision, blah, 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 to leave. We have the team of Rick Rude, King Kong Bundy, the One Man Gang, the Natural Butch Reed, and Andre the Giant versus Bam Bam Bigelow, Ken Patera, Mr. Wonderful Paul Orndorff, The Rock Don Morocco, and Hulk Hogan. This is the main event of the very first Survivor Series, and if you notice, we've only had three matches before this. So, like, literally, these Survivor Series matches were really long. And that tag team clusterfuck was even longer. And then you had the 15, 20 minutes of Ted DiBiase. So it was, I can't say it was the best airtime spent when you have so little matches involved. Andre the Giant wins, which makes this event significant and historic. Not only was this the first Survivor Series, but this was the first pay-per-view to feature a main event win by a heel. He became out sole survivor. Hogan, of course, attacks afterwards to allow him to get the hero celebration and, you know, I am a real American thing that he's done for so many years. A number of things were really bothersome from this. Hogan losing by countout made a lot of fans who wanted more of Hogan versus Andre very upset. This was the 80s, and you could hear a bullshit chant. You could actually hear the audience, like, you know, turning on this matchup towards the end there when Hulk Hogan loses by count out. That was just bad decision making. But they didn't want Andre to pin Hogan. Not yet. They still needed the whole bit to come out of Saturday night's main event. So I can understand why they did it. It just didn't come across as the smartest move. Bam Bam Bigelow put on one hell of a performance in this matchup, and it makes me wonder why the hell he wasn't pushed back then. He had the most effeminate, god-awful manager back then, and there's nothing wrong with a man being effeminate. It's just, this guy was flashy and pointless, and Bam Bam Bigelow was such an amazing athlete. He should have been somewhere near the WWF Championship or the Intercontinental Championship or anything. I think maybe they wanted to, but just didn't have a direction for him. And of course, as always, Jesse Ventura, whenever Hulk Hogan is doing anything and Hulk Hogan is winning, Jesse Ventura threatens to come out of retirement because he wants to get at Hogan and blah, 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 which he can't due to whatever concussion or neck. It was like a neck injury, if I remember correctly. I did some research on it. In the end, I gave the match a C+. I mean, and I gave a little bit of extra grade for the two things, Bam Bam's performance and the fact that a heel won the pay-per-view main event. Overall, Survivor Series 1987, the very first one, got a C+ grade from me. Not a bad start for an inaugural event, but not really a decent start. It's kind of like expecting to go out and drive a Honda, and I know Hondas aren't all that spectacular in some people's minds, but getting a Hyundai instead, or a Kia. It didn't quite meet what they were looking for. I think they were looking for a fancy Rolls Royce and got something more run-of-the-mill. All in all, it was an interesting and unique concept, and it was one that they would bring back again and again and again. Next time around, we'll be looking at Survivor Series 1988. And we'll be interested in seeing where this goes with another clusterfuck matchup. I'm Mr. Spiffy, and this has been Surviving Survivor Series. If you've survived, congratulations. And as always, please like, share, subscribe, and comment. And if you happen to also be a zombie right now because you didn't survive, please don't eat my brains.